I think it was kind of fun that Brother Steve was having a memory loss for a moment there, senior moment, whatever you want to call it. But and one of the things that's funny is the song that I'm singing this morning is called My Mind Forgets a Million Things. So I guess, Brother Steve, God put this one in my heart for you today. Goes by, so much has passed. Most things change, but some things last. So many days just slip away, mellowing there like yesterday. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. The things I've done, the things I've seen, melt into a lifelong dream, and I become what I've gone through. I am so glad I've been there with you. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. Will come when I'm so old. One more day will be like gold, and all the days I ever knew are measured by my life with you. My mind forgets a million things, places, dates, and names of kings. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you. Only one memory stays new, the day I gave my life to you.
I'm reminded of my grandmother. She seemed awful old at the time, but now I know that she wasn't. But there were my dad and his brother and his sister. They all had three children, and it was one boy and two girls in each family. So there were three of us grandboys, and we'd gather at my grandma and grandpa's house oftentimes, and we would stay together, and she would begin to want to call us for something. And sometimes it was to get on to us for, or to get on to them. I never needed it, but she would call them to get on to them. And when she would do that, she would be talking to me. And before she would call the name and she called me Stevie, she would call the name Ricky and David. And then she'd get around to the right name. If she were talking to David, she would call him Ricky and Stevie, and before she'd get to the right name. And the same with the other. And every time when she got through, we would kind of laugh at her. We shouldn't have, but we're just kids and we didn't know any better. So we would kind of laugh. And she followed it up with this statement. If I heard it one time, I heard it 1,000 times. You boys just wait till you're 62 years old. Now, when you're 8 or 10 years old, 62 is a foot in the grave and a foot on a banana peel, so to speak. But as of last week, I'm 1 year away from being within finger digits of 62, and 62 ain't near as old as it was back in 1970. But anyway, forget a lot of things, but I'm grateful that I pray I never forget the day I gave my heart and my life to Jesus. Take your Bible to Numbers, the 10th chapter. We will again follow this thought process today. Throughout Scripture, the Lord invites us to join Him in a lot of things. And a lot of things that He's doing and a lot of places that He has His people going. And you know, if we were invited to somebody as far as the world goes and thinks is important, we would let everybody know. And listen, here's one of the things that we forget it. We just neglect to put it in proper perspective. But the Creator God of the universe is inviting us to join Him in some things that He's doing even still today. So last week we began this thought and we talked about that we were invited or called to a cleansing, and we used the verse Isaiah, the first chapter and the 18th verse, where the verse just begins with the two words, come now. So there's the invitation to come and join Him. He said, come now and let us reason together, says the Lord, capital L-O-R-D, all capitalized. It's the Yahweh of the Old Testament, is Jehovah of the New Testament. And then He says, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are like crimson, they shall be as wool. And we talked about how scarlet and crimson were color-fast stains that humankind had no way of getting rid of them. But the Lord said, even though your sins are impossible for you to get rid of, He said, I will make them as white as snow if you will come and if you will join me. Well, today we're offered another invitation, and we find it in Numbers, the 10th chapter, beginning with the 29th, reading down through the 32nd verse. Let me read it to you, and then I'll give you some context so that we understand what's going on. In the 29th verse, Moses is speaking, and he is speaking to a man by the name of Hobab. And it says this, now Moses said to Hobab, the son of Reuel, the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law. Now Moses begins to speak. We are setting out for the place of which the Lord said, I will give it to you. So then Moses says, come with us, and we will treat you well. For the Lord has promised good things to Israel. So Hobab speaks back to Moses and he says, I will not go, but I will depart to my own land and to my relatives. So Moses speaks back to Hobab, please do not leave. Inasmuch as you know, we are to camp in the wilderness and you can be our eyes. And it shall be if you go with us, indeed it shall be, that whatever good the Lord will do to us, the same we will do to you. Now here's the context of this passage. The children of Israel, they are preparing to break camp, if you would. They're preparing to leave their encampment. They're at the foot of Mount Sinai, and a lot of things have happened here. They have received the law. They have built the tabernacle. They have learned how to worship the Lord God. And now they're breaking camp and they're headed to this place that was promised to them a long, long time ago. And we're kind of following it through Abraham on Sunday night right now. But they're going to break camp and they're going to head toward Canaan. They're going to head toward the promised land. But before they leave, Moses takes time to offer an invitation to one who is not a part of the covenant people, not a part of the children of Israel, as it were. And he takes this time to invite Hobab to join them to go to their destination, the promised land. Now, you say, well, who is this for today, Brother Steve? Well, I believe in this particular message and in this particular passage of Scripture, there's a word for the church. And we all know that the church is not a building, but the church is a people. So if you're a part of the church today, then this message is for you. There's also a word in this message today, or a challenge for those who are outside the church. A lot of people in our day today, they say, well, the church is not all that important anymore. Well, undoubtedly it is, because Jesus loved the church enough that he gave himself for it. So the church is important, always has been. And there's a word for every person in this room, regardless of what may be going on in your life. So we look into this passage, and we find the following three things that Moses invites Hobab to share in along with the people. First of all, he invites him to share in the pilgrimage. We find that in the 29th verse. Now, he invites him, I'm not going to reread that verse, but he invites him to join a special people. Now, the children of Israel are a special people. They're not a special people because I say they're a special people or because a certain denomination believes they're a special people. But the Bible tells us that they're a special group of people because God proclaimed them to be a special group of people. Now, when Moses is talking to Hobab and he is referring to himself and the children of Israel, he uses the word us, and he also uses the word we. So he talks about them, and he is inviting, and I believe Hobab to be his father-in-law, and he invites him to join a special group of people. Now, they're special because the Bible tells us in Deuteronomy, the 7th chapter and the 6th verse, here's what it says. It says, for you are a holy people, talking about the children of Israel. You're a holy people to the Lord your God. The Lord God has chosen you to be a people for himself, a special treasure above all the peoples of the face of the earth. So what do we note about the children of Israel? Well, they were a redeemed people. According to Exodus, the 15th chapter and the 13th verse, it says there, speaking of God, you in your mercy have led forth the people whom you have redeemed. And we've been talking about redemption on Wednesday night for quite some time, so we understand what that means. So what does that mean today? Well, it means that the saints of God are special. If you're a born-again Christian, not a church member, but a born-again Christian, you are special. And you're special because the Word of God declares you to be so. Why are we special? Because according to the Word of God, He chose us. None of us chose Him. He chose us. The Bible says in Ephesians 1:4, it says that He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world. The Bible says in John 15:6, you did not choose me, Jesus said, but I chose you. And I appointed you that you should go forth and bear fruit. And the verse goes on. So we're a chosen people. We're a redeemed people. We've been using the verse out of 1 Peter, the first chapter, and the 18th and 19th verse, where the Scripture says, and I'll paraphrase, it says, you weren't redeemed with those things that pass away and those corruptible things. But he said, you were redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. I'm telling you this morning, if you're saved, you're special. And you're not special because you think so, and you're not special because I think so. We're special because God thinks so. We're special because he has chosen us, he has redeemed us, and he has chosen us to follow him. So they're a special group of people, and they're a special group of people that are going to a special place. Well, the scripture tells us that Moses invites his father-in-law to join them to go to a place that God began promising back in Genesis, the 12th chapter, when he spoke to Abraham about this journey that they were going to embark upon. And he told them, he said, there's a land that I'm going to give you. And they are headed out for this land. The Bible tells us this in Exodus, the 3rd chapter, in the 8th verse. And I think this may be the first time. If it's not the first, it's among the first of about 20 times that the Word of God speaks about the land of promise, or the promised land, as a land flowing, or a land of milk and honey. Here's Exodus 3:8. I have come down to deliver them out of the land of the Egyptians, and to bring them up from that land to a good land and a large land, to a land that is flowing with milk and honey. And that's where this group of people are breaking camp at the foot of Mount Sinai, and they're headed to this promised land that God has promised his people, and they're headed to a special place. Brethren, as a special people of believers today, we're headed to a special place. You remember the old song, I don't know if it's in our hymnal or not, but it's in the old Heavenly Highway songbook. That old hymn that says, this world is not my home. I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. It was Moses, it was his God-given authority, and I believe also it was his obligation to invite his father-in-law to become a part of the people and to join them on this journey with a special people headed to a special place. And brethren, if you're a born-again Christian, we're headed to a special place. And it's not Shoney's, it's not Grandy, it's not the Catfish King after church. We're headed to heaven, bless God. And Scripture tells us that we're supposed to invite people to go with us. Listen, we can enjoy life, and I hope that you do, and life has its ups and life has its downs. Life has its good days. Life has its bad days. Life has its enjoyment, and life has its sorrows. But brethren, we're headed to a place where none of those negative things are going to occur. Nobody's ever going to come on the news like they did last night and announce that an airplane crashed in the swamps down there close to Houston, Texas. Nobody's going to go to a doctor's office and get a report and says you have cancer. Nobody's going to go anywhere. The funeral homes are going to be out of business because all of those things, according to the Bible, says all those things are passed away. There will be no sorrow. There'll be no crying. There'll be no death. There'll be no more tears in that place. There'll be no pain because the Scripture says all those things have passed away. Now, I'm telling you, that's a pretty good deal. If we had tickets, if it were full-blown baseball, see, by the way, the Astros play their first spring training game today. Split squad, so there's two of them, B. I don't know if you can get them both or not. You ever want to know what the Astros are doing? B. Stovall is your person. She knows. If it were baseball season and somebody gave us the 40-some-odd thousand tickets to Minute Maid Park, game time was tonight at 6 o'clock, and we had 40 or 45,000 tickets at our disposal. There's no doubt that we would go around to people and say, hey, come, join me down here at Minute Maid Park. Minute Maid Park would be a devastating pits of hell place compared to the place we're going. And I ask you this morning, how many people have we invited to come with us? That's what Scripture tells us today. Come share in our pilgrimage. Join a special people headed to a special place. And they also have a special privilege. You see, I've already mentioned this, but Hobab is not a part of the children of Israel. He is not a part of the covenant that God has with Israel. And so he's not a part of the promises that God has made to Israel. So what Moses does is Moses has the privilege. He has the opportunity to invite Hobab to come and to join them on the journey and to share in the blessings. And he has the privilege of just saying, hey, come with us. Come with us. What belongs to us will belong to you. The blessings we have, they're yours. And listen, brethren, I know it's old-fashioned and I know we don't do this much anymore, but that's what we're supposed to be doing, is inviting people to come with us. This world is not our home. Heaven is our home. That's where we're headed. And we need to be inviting people. Listen, heaven and salvation are one of those things that as we give it away, we actually have more than we had to start with. If I had $100 broken down anyway, if I had 100 ones, if I had 25s or 520s, or 10 tens, if I went around and I gave it away, I'd give some over here and some over here and some till I gave it all away, I would get down to the place where I had given away what I had and I would have none left. But with what God has given us, the more we give away, the more we have. Scripture speaks of a principle that we don't pay a whole lot of attention to anymore, and it's a principle that we read about in Matthew, the 6th chapter, beginning with the 19th verse. And it says there, gives us a word of instruction, do not, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in. But then he says in the 20th verse, he says, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven. And then he says, where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves can't break in and steal. And then he says this, for where your treasure is, there your heart's going to be also. Let me just give you a principle here, a truth. If your heart is on all of the things of this world, if that's where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. But if we're laying up treasure up there, that's where our heart's going to be. And the more of Jesus that we give away, the more we have. Heaven, there's a song out on radio. I don't know what radio you listen to, but I listen to a satellite radio station, and there's a song out right now. I don't even know who sings it, but it talks about the fact that heaven just got sweeter. And every time, and we understand the context, every time that somebody passes from this life that's our loved one and they get to go to heaven, the more we have there. Well, it not only goes for our families, for moms and dads and grandmas and grandpas. Listen, it goes for all those people that we have shared Christ with. Listen, that's what we need to be doing. We have a special privilege to invite people to go to a special place with us. So he invites them to come and share in the pilgrimage. And then we also see that in as we go on down through the verses, we find that he says to come share in the partnership. Come share in the partnership. So he invites Hobab to, in essence, to join the family. Join the family. Come thou with us. Hobab is not a part of the children of Israel. He is outside of the covenant that God has with the people. So if we could relate that to today, we could say that he's a lost man. He's a lost man without Christ. And so Moses invites him to come with them. Now, as a lost man, Hobab is cut off from the blessings. He is cut off from the promises of the Lord. He has no hope of salvation. He has no, in fact, apart from accepting the invitation that Moses gives to him, and I believe it would be under the leadership of God, apart from accepting this invitation, he doesn't have a chance. So Moses invites him to join the family. Now listen to me this morning. We need to understand and we need to remember this and we need to never forget it. Even today, there is no hope of heaven outside of a relationship with Jesus Christ. You can be a member of 47 different churches. You can join every denomination across the board, all across America. You can do all of those things and die without Jesus Christ, and you have no hope. I'm telling you this morning that you don't get saved by joining a church. You don't get saved by serving in a church. You don't get saved by showing up for work day. You don't get saved by being baptized. You don't get saved by partaking of the Lord's Supper. You don't get saved by partaking of any of the rituals. I'm telling you this morning, just as it was in this day, so it is in our day, that outside of a personal relationship with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, none of us have any hope of heaven. I could show up at heaven, in heaven, and I don't know exactly how it's going to work, and I don't think it's going to work the way I'm fixing to speak of, but you'll get the context of it. I could walk up and be met at the gate, and I could say, my name is the Reverend Steve Cowart. I've pastored churches for 25, 30 years. I've sang hundreds of gospel songs, and I've done this, and I've done this, and I've done this, and I've done all of these things, and it would all sound good and all of those things, but when he began to flip through the Lamb's Book of Life, if my name doesn't appear there, that I've given my heart and my life to Jesus Christ, I will not be accepted in. Not on the basis of any of my work. It's only through a relationship with the Lord Jesus. So today, the greatest need is not that we join a particular church family, though that is important. It's that we know we belong to the family of God. And I'm telling you this morning, when we come to know the Lord Jesus Christ and we enter into a personal relationship with Him and we join the family, man, you remember that old commercial? And I can't remember what the company was that had this commercial, but they said membership has its privileges. You remember that? I think it was a credit card company, if I remember right. Membership has its privilege. I'm telling you, to be a member of the family of God has its benefits. It has its privileges. I'm telling you this morning, when we become a member of the family of God, we're entitled to all the rights and all the privileges thereof. The Bible tells us in the Gospel of John, the 3rd chapter and the 3 verses, it tells us about a man of the Pharisees, and his name was Nicodemus. And Nicodemus, the Bible says, he came to Jesus by night and he said to him, he said, Rabbi, he said, well, I know you're a teacher come from God, for no one can do the things that you have done unless God is with him. And then Jesus answered and said to Nicodemus, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom. It was true then. It's still true today. When we come into the family, we're adopted into the family of God. The scripture says we don't receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but we receive the spirit of adoption. Adopted into the King's family. That's pretty good. We secure a place in heaven. John 14, the 3 verses, Jesus is speaking, and he told the disciples, he said, don't let your heart be troubled. He said, you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, he says, are many mansions. If it weren't so, I would have told you so. I'm going to go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, he said, I'm going to come again. So that where I am, and that I is Jesus, that where I am, there you may be also. Man, the Bible says in Hebrews 7:25, it doesn't say we're just going to get in by the skin of, you ever use that? You ever pass a class in school by the skin of your teeth? I passed a bunch of them. I failed some by the skin of my teeth, but I passed a few by the skin of my teeth. Well, that's not the way it is when we get saved. Hebrews 7:25 talks about that he is able to save, and he uses this word, to the uttermost. He can take us from the guttermost to the uttermost. I'm telling you, membership has its privileges. And Moses says, come thou with us, Hobab. He said, not only join our family, but join our fellowship. He uses the phrase as he goes on. He says, we, not I, we will do you good. We will do you or thee good. So Moses is telling him. He's telling old Hobab, he said, if you will come with us, we will treat you right. God is blessing us, and we want to share those blessings with you. We won't hurt you, Hobab, but we'll do our best to be a blessing to you. So in essence, or in reality, Moses is saying two things to Hobab. One, he is saying, Hobab, you need us. But he's also saying, we need you. We need you. Now, why would the people of God, why would they need Hobab? He's not a part of the covenant. He's not a part of that group of people. You remember what they're fixing to do here? They're going to break camp at the base of Mount Sinai. And they're going to go on this journey to the promised land. Well, one of the places that they're going to have to cross is the desert. Guess what just happens to be Hobab's specialty? The desert. I've never been to the desert. I don't know if there are any deserts left in the world as much rain as we've had this year. I've never been to the desert. I've never seen the desert, but I'm of the understanding that when you're in the desert, there's not much water there. Well, Hobab, you see, the desert is Hobab's territory. This is area that he knows the best. So Hobab, he knows the best campsites. Hobab knows where what little water that there is, he knows about it. Hobab knows where the best trails are. Hobab knows the best way to get across there. And so the people of God need Hobab. Now, Hobab needs the people of God because outside of accepting this invitation, I stated this a while ago, outside of accepting this invitation, he has no way of knowing the Lord. But the people of God need Hobab. Now, hang on. Some of you are not going to agree with me here, but it's your right to be wrong if that's what you choose to do. The church, lost people out in the world, they need the church. They need the God that we serve. But I'm telling you this morning, the church needs them. The church needs them. You say, why do we need them, Brother Steve? Because when you get saved, the Bible tells us not only do we secure a place in heaven, not only do we secure all of those things or some of those things that I mentioned to you a while ago, but the Bible tells us that we're indwelt by the Spirit of God. And when we are indwelt by the Spirit of God, we are also gifted by the Spirit of God. Now, I'm not going to take time to read this to you this morning, but you can go over, I think it's in 1 Corinthians, and I forget the chapter, I'll give it to you later, but you can begin to read about the gifts that the Holy Spirit gives. And the reason that the Holy Spirit gifts believers is for the edification and the betterment and the ministry of the church. There are certain things that you can do that I can't do, certain things I can do that you can't do, and there are certain things that somebody out there can do that you and I neither one can do, that nobody else can do like they are. And I'm telling you this morning, the church needs those people. And we need to go out there and we need to invite them to come with us. Most churches across the spectrum today, you notice this is true here. And if we just base it on our congregation here today, the church is getting very old. I don't mean that ugly, but you just look around. The church is getting old. And I'm telling you, if we don't begin to invite and we don't begin to bring people along with us, the local church, many of the local churches as we know it, they're in trouble. They're in trouble. I trust that it blesses your heart on Sunday morning to see these little children get up as Jesus Loves Me plays on the piano and head back for children's church. I hope it blesses your heart that there's a mess down there at the end of the hall on Sunday morning. I hope it blesses you that there's Kool-Aid spilt on the carpet. I hope it blesses you that there's a mess in the floor. I hope it blesses you that there's handprints on the doorways. We need them. We need them. They need us. And we need them. And then there's one other thing. Now, let me just mention this. And I believe this today. Is that there are people that we have to be careful of. The Bible tells us in 3 John. We rarely go to that 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John back there. Just before Jude and Revelation. But in 3 John, there's only one what we would call a chapter. But in the 9th verse, I want to read you this verse. John is writing, and here's what he says. He says, I wrote to the church, but, now listen to this, but Diotrephes, not sure why anybody would name their son Diotrephes, but Diotrephes, who loves to have the preeminence. So what does it mean, preacher? It means what I've said time after time after time. There is no place for neither you nor I to be the preeminent. He and He alone is the preeminent one. And I'm telling you today that there are people inside the churches that they want things to run around them. The church was never designed to run around us. The church was designed to run and function around Him. And He warned us in this passage that though there's that spirit of Diotrephes, he says, you be careful. You be careful that doesn't happen. So he says, we get back to our line. Come share in the pilgrimage, come share in the partnership, and then come share in the promise. Well, Moses is talking to Hobab. And he tells him, he says, the Lord hath spoken good things concerning Israel. So he's inviting Hobab to share in all the blessings that God has promised to give to Israel. Such as, well, to come share in the promise of a home. Where are they headed? To Canaan. They're headed to this place where God has promised them and they've been hearing about for a long period of time. Moses was saying, hey, this wilderness, this desert, this is not our final destination. And brethren, this world's not our final destination. Lynn, I counted this morning. Lynn always asks me at the hospital, or he has several times, he said, have you counted the number of people on the prayer list that have cancer? On our Wednesday night bulletin, I think the number for the bulletin coming out this week will be 55. The Sunday bulletin that you were handed today when you came, it's about, there's a few less, and I don't know why they're not there, but there's about 45 or 50 of them. I'm telling you this morning, we are headed to a place where none of those things come. No more infusions, Charlotte. No more chemo treatments for anybody. No more Alzheimer reports. No more of any of those things. Listen, brethren, we are headed to a place, and I think we have a lot of misconceptions about heaven. I think that we're going to do to the uttermost or to the nth degree up there the things that we do. I don't think that. I think that the Bible teaches us that heaven is a land of worship. It is a land of worship. I don't have time to read this to you, but you can go and read it for yourself. Read Revelation, the 4th chapter and the 5th chapter. And then you go flip over to the 7th chapter and begin in about verse 9. Go down about 10 or 12 verses. And you're going to find out that heaven is a place where the redeemed ones worship the Redeemer. The redeemed ones are going to worship the Redeemer. You say, Brother Steve, I get bored in an hour church service. There won't be an hour up there. Because we will have stepped outside of time. He's already outside of time. Time only affects me and you. When we get up there, there'll be no clocks on the wall. We're not going to get older. We're not going to get hungry, I don't think. I'm not sure that. Randy Bowles may. He gets hungry all the time. But most of us are not going to get hungry. And it's just going to be a land of worship. Then we can read over in Revelation 21 and 22, and we can find that it's a land of wonders. Words can't begin to describe. It's walls of jasper, gates of pearl, foundations of precious stones that I can't pronounce. Streets are made with transparent gold, and the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible says, will illuminate heaven. It's a land of wonders, and it's a land of wellness. No sickness. None of those things are going to be there. They will, in essence, they'll all be banned at the gate. Brethren, that's where we're going. And if you can't invite anybody to go there, where can you invite them to go? So he said, come share in the promises, the promise of a home, and also the promise of hope. The phrase in verse 29 that says, we'll give it to you. It's filled with promise. Moses is inviting Hobab to come and to rest on the promises of the Lord. He's saying, Hobab, there's hope for tomorrow. The Lord Himself has promised us that there are better things than He's talking about the place where they're gathered here at the foot of Mount Sinai. He said, hey, there's a better place awaiting us. There's better things down the road than here. We're headed to the promised land. And that's the hope of the believer today. That's my hope. And that has to be your hope. Is the hope of this place, brethren. The Bible teaches us in Hebrews 4:9 that there's going to be a day of rest. Listen to this verse. There remains therefore a rest for the people of God. Rest from what? A rest from all of our sorrows. A rest from all of our troubles. A rest from all of our sicknesses. A rest from all of the things that we deal with down here. I'm telling you, brother, there's coming a day of rest. And there's also coming a day of reunion. When those whom you have loved, those who were a part of your life, for parents for many of you, spouses for some of you, the whole deal, the Bible says that there's coming a day when all of those who know the Lord Jesus, we're going to be joined together. And there's going to be a wonderful day of reunion. And it's not going to be one afternoon to meet down at a civic center somewhere and have a potluck dinner, but it's going to be eternal. It's never going to end. There's going to be a wonderful day of reunion. There's going to be a wonderful day of reward. Sometimes we get all down in the mouth. Oh, Brother Bud McGee, second pastor that I ever worked under, he used to use this phrase, you look like you got the mully grubs. I'm not sure what you look like when you look like you have the mully grubs, but he would say that. And a lot of people get the mully grubs over things like this. Well, nobody noticed what I did down there at the church. Brother, let me tell you something just to cheer your little heart up. The Scripture says, if you're doing it for the applause of man, that once the applause comes and once the applause ends, you have your reward. But when it is done for the honor and the glory of God, no man may notice it at all. But I'm telling you, he does. He's not sitting there with an iPad documenting everything, because God just knows everything. And there's a day coming, brethren, when all of those things, the things that we've done that were for self and for the wrong deals, they will be those things that are wood, hay, and stubble, and they'll all burn away. And all that's going to be left are the things that we have done for the Lord. And there's going to be a day of reward for all of those things. I'm telling you, man, there is a wonderful day. There's a promise of hope, but there's also, let me finish with this. He said, come share in the promise of help. Of help. Their journey is, I don't know how long it's going to take them, and I don't know what they're looking at as they leave, but he said this. He said, the Lord has spoken good concerning Israel. Listen, the Lord didn't redeem these people to leave them in the desert to die. He redeemed them to bring them to the land that he had promised them. And I'm telling you today, the Lord didn't save you to leave you. I noticed that song you sang came out of an Imperials book when you closed it. I noticed that. The Imperials used to sing another song. I don't know the name of it, but if you were around in the late 70s and listening to the Imperials, you remember it, and I don't know the name of it, but it went something like this. He didn't bring us this far to leave us. He didn't teach us to swim to let us drown. You remember that? Some of you looking like a cow looking at a new gate. You don't have any idea. Google it. You can Google everything. Google it and find it. I'm telling you, he has promised to help us. What has he promised to help us with? He has promised to sustain us. Look it up in Philippians 4:9 and Matthew 6:25. He's promised to sanctify us. That is to bring us, to make us a holy people, a set apart people, a separate people. He's called us to be a new creation. He has called us to walk in the newness of life, and he is going to help us to do that. He's promised to satisfy us. I'm telling you, that's a chore for the average church today. But I'm telling you, it is a promise of God that he is going to satisfy us. And I tell you this, we can never satisfy one another. You've all got acquaintances, we'll call them friends, whatever you want to call them, and we're with them for a period of time, but when they do something that we don't necessarily like, they're past. You know any of those? I'll be honest, I do. I'm telling you this morning, it is only the Lord that can provide perfect satisfaction. And he has promised to do that. He's promised to secure us. To secure us. God did what he promised, and he brought Israel. If you follow this story out, he brings Israel to the place through the promised land. And listen, God's going to do the same with us. We are secure in him. Remember all the bank commercials they used to say your deposits are good up to $250,000 according to the FDIC, Federal Deposit Insurance Company, or whatever that stood for? That's only as secure as the government. You watch how the government handles money. That's not much security nowadays. You're secure in him. Brethren, you are secure. Your job may not be secure. Your Social Security may not be secure. Your retirement may not be secure. Your home may not be secure. Your car may not be secure. But if you're a born-again child of God, you are secure in Jesus Christ. And you can rest in it. You can rest in it. So he said, come with us. Come with us, Hobab. Be a part of what God is doing with us, what God is doing in us, what God is doing for us. Come with us. You are invited to companionship, to be a part of the family. Caroline, will you step to the piano? Here's what I want to do. I've never done an invitation like this. And I know it's against Baptist bylaw. We ain't never done it this way before. I thought of a song this morning, and I'm not going to sing it for a special, but I'm going to sing it for the invitation. And this morning, I don't know, it's Lord, I'm Coming Home. I don't know what number it is. I didn't look it up. This morning, I believe with all my heart that the Holy Spirit, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, they're the three in one. And I believe that God knows everything, so therefore I believe that the Holy Spirit does as well. So this morning, the Holy Spirit knows what's going on in everybody's life all the way across this room. And there are some in this room that He may be calling to be saved. So, well, Brother Steve, it's 11:45 now, and I'll just have to do that later. Well, good luck to you. Because the Bible starts out way back in the early beginning days of Scripture. In fact, it's in Genesis, the 6th chapter and the 3rd verse. And the Word of God says this, "My Spirit," that's Holy Spirit, "will not strive with you forever." That means it's not up to you. It's up to when He calls you through the calling of the Holy Spirit. So this morning, if you've never been saved and the Spirit of God is speaking to your heart that you need to give your heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ, today's the day. Scripture tells us that today is the day of salvation. It doesn't just go until the day that you die. It goes until He stops calling you. And when the Holy Spirit no longer calls, we can no longer come. So if you need to be saved, today is the day. If you need to join this church, you need to join the people. And before you do, realizing it's not about any of us. There's one chief and there's one head, and it's Him. You may just have things in your life that you need to get right with God. And today's the day. And this moment's the moment. We're going to stand. I'm going to pray. And then we're going to remain with heads bowed. And if you need to come to this altar, pray. You need to come down here and share your heart with someone and to be saved. I'll meet with you in a moment. But I'm just going to begin to sing several verses of this old invitation song. And this is not Brother Steve's invitation to you. This is His invitation to you. Because He loves you. Let's stand and pray. Father, thank You for this time in Your house today. Thank You for calling us out of sin, calling us out of rebellion, calling us out of waywardness, just calling us to come to You for whatever need may be relevant in our life. Lord, You are issuing a call to us to come and join You, to be a part of Your church, to be a part of Your family, and to be a part of the blessings that You have promised to those who know You in the free pardon of sin. I pray today that as You speak to hearts and lives in this sanctuary today, that we will respond to You and we'll allow You to meet those needs in our lives. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Heads bowed and eyes closed. If you need to come to this altar, you come. I've wandered far away from God. Now I'm coming home. Those paths presence of sin, Lord, too long I've trod. Lord, I'm coming home, coming home, I'm coming home, nevermore to roam. Open wide thine arms of love, Lord, I'm coming home. I've wasted many precious years. Now, Lord, I'm coming home. I now repent with bitter tears. Lord, I'm coming home, coming home, Lord, I'm coming home. Nevermore to roam. Open wide thine arms of love, because, Lord, I'm coming home. Would you continue to play, Carolyn? Another verse or two. All right. Little Mason came in the other Wednesday night. Mason is 6, going on 26. And he come in after church. He and Carla came in after church, and he'd been talking about being saved and salvation. And 6 years, are you about to turn 7? Close, about to turn 7. And we always wonder, you know, are they old enough? But we always have to remember that he told us to come like them. He never told them to come like us. He told us if we were coming to him, we had to come with their kind of faith. Never are they instructed to come with our kind of faith. So he comes with his childlike faith to put his faith and trust in Jesus. He's prayed the prayer of salvation. He didn't do it Wednesday night. He's done it a period of time ago, and he believes it, and I believe it as well. So he comes, and he comes on public profession of his faith, and we'll get a time set for baptism for him. So you be in prayer for Mason, and name has slipped me. Carrie come today to unite with our church, and Carrie is Wanda's daughter, and comes from Ebenezer Baptist Church down toward Jasper, down toward the lake down there, and she wants to become a part of Trinity Baptist Church. So if you're thankful for that, we're not going to vote on it because he accepted them without us, without our okay, but we just rejoice with them. That's all we do. And so they'll be kind of back there at the door with me when we get ready to go, and you can greet them there. Okay? All right. You need to say anything, Mason? No? Okay. All right.
Heavenly Father, thank you for these messages. Lord, I want to thank you for this little boy that came this morning, Lord. As Steve asked the question, Lord, about his age, Lord, I remember Dr. Charles Stanley sharing how when he was just that age, Lord, he accepted you, called to the ministry, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that he's plenty old enough. Thank you, Lord, that he don't understand everything, because we don't, Lord. And I pray for him, Lord. I pray for this lady that came to be a part of this church today, Lord. I pray that she feels a part before she leaves out the door today, that she's found her a family right here this morning, Lord. And, Lord, I just thank you, Brother Steve. Thank you for his willingness to preach the Bible. Thank you for him, Lord, and I pray a blessing over him and this church, their staff. In Jesus' name.